The shark. Man-eater. Monster of the deep. And these days, friend of Hollywood. This is a clip from one of the latest offerings. We'll show you later how films like this are made. But in this program, we also ask, what is a shark? What makes it tick? And will it really eat you? The shark in Jaws is, of course, a fake. It's a hydraulic machine, and in the script, it terrorizes an East Coast resort and removes sundry bathers. It's fiction, but is it also fact?
And the weather forecast for the greater Daytona Beach area, high 82 degrees today. It's a perfect day on the world's most famous beach.
The movie Jaws opened last summer, and seaside resorts complained it had frightened the tourists. Municipal lifeguards were no reassurance. Very few people went in the sea. And in Florida, they had good reason not to. Because last summer, the Jaws fable became reality. Altogether, six bathers were attacked during the season. All survived, but not intact. In August, surgeons had to amputate the leg of a 13-year-old boy who had been swimming in the shallows off Daytona Beach. The shark was not seen. It's the latest entry to be registered here in the International Shark Attack File in Florida. It contains records of over 1,500 shark attacks, mostly on the young, and many fatal.
The shark had Bob in its mouth and was shaking Bob like a leaf. It broke Bob in half and rose up at me with Bob's legs sticking out of its mouth. Bob's upper half floated to the surface. His feet and flippers were still projecting from its mouth.
He kept screaming and screaming. I could tell the fish was chewing him up. It was a horrible scream. He was shouting, "Help me, help me." I grabbed for his hand.
The victim, a 25-year-old African male, screamed and rose vertically out of the water. The entire left leg had been severed. The top of the femur was shattered as if by a terrific blow. The right leg was clearly
al tallone con asportazione di tessuto muscolare.
In all the attacks, one thing stands out. They were unpredictable.
Most often in shark attack, there's absolutely no warning that anything's going to happen. You very rarely see a fin slicing the water. About two-thirds of victims never see the shark at all before the attack. Quite often there's very, very little pain, even though the wounds themselves might be very severe, and even limbs lost with practically no pain. This is something we don't understand at all.
In fact, it's all a mystery. A computer analysis of the 1,700 cases asked, is there any pattern to shark attacks? The answer is no. Sharks will strike anyone, anywhere, at any time, in waters of any depth, even 18 inches, and any temperature.
Very often, an attacking shark will single out a particular individual among a group of individuals. There seems to be some sort of locking on that happens, in that the shark pays essentially all of its attention then to the selected individual, and in most cases, rescuers are not injured in any way as the shark tries again and again to get around them to the original victim.
These are just a few of the killers. The hammerhead shark, with its strange flattened snout. The tiger shark. It can reach 18 feet long and weigh a ton. A most vicious killer. It's been seen to swallow men whole. And the great white shark, the biggest killer of all. It reigns supreme in the sea. It has no natural enemies. Except, that is, for man.
Welcome to the Great White Shark Exhibit. This shark that you see here was taken on July 23rd, 1975, about 25 miles off the coast of Los Angeles. Inside, they found the remains of two harbor seals slightly digested. But there were no human remains found inside this shark. The shark is a top predator in the ocean, and as a predator, they play an important role. They help to weed out the weak, injured, sick,
Wherever there are sharks, you'll find people who fish them. They can be caught like any other fish, only they're much more fun.
I got it to the boat, and then it went zoom about. Oh, must have done it 20 times, I should say.
This is one of many species of shark found in coastal waters. It's called a basking shark, and it's a massive 30 feet long. But it's perfectly harmless. It eats only plankton. In fact, most sharks are harmless. They eat fish, squid, mollusk, almost anything but man. There are over 300 species of shark. Most of them less than 4 feet long, and they are found from the tropics to the Arctic. Their closest relatives are the skates and rays. Sharks first appeared in the sea 300 million years ago and have reigned supreme ever since. The biggest of them is a whale shark, up to 50 feet long, but harmless. They are the oldest large animals in the world, but they have remained primitive, simple creatures. This is the brain of a 6-foot-long dolphin, and its size and structure are much like our own. And this is the brain of a 6-foot shark. Much more primitive. But then for the shark, that may not be a problem. At Plymouth Marine Biological Laboratory in England, Dr. Quinton Bone has been studying one of the smaller sharks, the dogfish.
This dogfish, which you see here, sitting quite comfortably swimming away, you might be surprised to know I took its brain out at 1:30 today, and ever since it's been swimming steadily without a brain, and it'll go on swimming, as far as we know, for several days. It's swimming quite automatically by a kind of segmental computer in this part of the body. And this computer not only is driving the fish like this, as you can see from side to side, but it's ingeniously altering the angle of attack of the fins. And you can see these fins at the back, if you look closely, are moving against the angle of the motion of the body. So the animal, although it's dead, it's been dead since 1:30 when its brain was destroyed, is swimming in a very regular, steady kind of way at about 37 beats a minute.
A machine, primitive but superbly designed. It's swimming governed by an automatic pilot. And in many ways, the shark is an aircraft. Its wings, the fins in front, the back ones are stabilizers. Like an aircraft, sharks are heavier than water. If they stopped moving, they'd sink. Some sharks need forward motion, too, to get water through their gills. Otherwise, they'd drown. A shark seems a simple machine. How has it survived so successfully? In a basement room at Stanford University in California, Leonard Campagno is, at 26, already one of the world's leading authorities on shark taxonomy. He believes that one of the reasons sharks have survived is because of the variety of their teeth.
This shows, for example, the jaw of a sand tiger shark, and it's primarily a fish eater, and it has some very interesting functional regions of teeth that do different things. Like the front teeth right here are impaling teeth that tend to spike the fish, and the side teeth here have a bit more cutting action that serve to cut the fish, and the rear teeth can crush or can hold on to things. Sharks don't have to go to the dentist because they don't have to worry about such little problems as that because they constantly replace their teeth. In the back, each of these rows of teeth that you see right there is a veritable tooth factory, and teeth are being continually manufactured at the back and being pushed up and out. And as this happens, of course, the other teeth are being pushed outward and they eventually drop off. In some sharks, you even get the situation where when they're about to drop their teeth, they actually swallow their teeth and so conserve the calcium.
Crushing teeth, cutting and slicing teeth. Individually designed for each species and superbly crafted. But the success story doesn't end there. This is a nurse shark, one of the few that can be kept in captivity. And they're going to take a blood sample. No shark's going to let you do that without a struggle. So the tank is laced with anesthetic. Why? Because scientists have discovered that for some reason, sharks are immune from disease. They've found that the shark, like us, has antibodies in its blood to protect it from disease. Only their antibodies are primitive, in theory at any rate. Here at Miami University, a team has been seeing what happens when you add shark antibodies to human viruses, like influenza and polio, and a whole range of harmful bacteria. Theory says nothing should happen, but these food poisoning bacteria were laid low by the shark. Human viruses, too, were destroyed. Sharks are totally immune to diseases they would never meet. Why they have such wide immunity is a mystery. But it certainly must be useful. Sharks are, after all, scavengers. But that's part of their success. They've survived because they're adaptable. And that means eat anything that's going. And sometimes they go to extremes. Some pretty strange objects have been found in sharks. 9 assorted shoes, 5 hens, 24 bottles of Vichy water, a tomcat, a car license plate, a stuffed penguin, an overcoat, and a handbag containing 3 silver dollars, a powder puff, and a wristwatch. Strangest of all, an 18th century shark was found to contain a knight in armor. On the face of it, sharks seem pretty odd. Their occasional strange diet may account for their popular image as stupid. Others more charitably say the shark has poor eyesight. But they looked into that one some time ago. Dr. Sam Gruber in Miami has conditioned a shark to blink at the flash of a light, and he's found it may have better eyesight than we do. It's up to 10 times more sensitive to light. A shark can also pick out fast-moving images, which to us would be a blur. So what about its intelligence? Well, just watch this. As part of his research on eyesight, Dr. Gruber has constructed a standard laboratory test of learning ability. The shark is given a problem. Discriminate between the dark and the bright light. If he gets it right, he'll get fed. It's clear sharks are not totally stupid. They learned this little trick as fast as laboratory animals like the rabbit, which has a more sophisticated brain than the shark. So why do they eat these strange objects? At Plymouth, Dr. Barry Roberts has discovered it may be an accident. He's working on the dogfish and has been looking at its jaw-closing mechanism. He's found that the shark has a particular reflex that is yet another remarkable weapon in its armory.
We have found in the jaws of a shark that beneath the teeth, that's the upper jaw, lower jaw, beneath the teeth, there are sensors that respond to small movements of the teeth. These movements occur when the fish bites on the prey. The sensors respond and send signals to the brain and onto another nerve cell in the brain, which comes back onto the jaw muscles and makes the jaws contract. The whole process takes perhaps 7 milliseconds, 7/1000ths of a second, which is as fast as the shark could make it happen.
A useful reflex, but it might cause problems. Because if there's a strong smell of food in the water, sharks will get overexcited and go into what's called a feeding frenzy, and they'll bite at anything.
With any object, a being or some object floating at the surface that comes into the jaws of the shark and touches the teeth will automatically set off this jaw-closing reflex.
So sharks may eat strange objects by accident, but not according to David Baldridge.
I think the eating of strange, heavy, indigestible objects is an intentional thing by sharks. A shark's balance, its buoyancy balance, is an extremely delicate thing.
A shark gets buoyancy from its liver. Stuffed full of oil, the liver can be almost a third of the weight of the whole body. But Baldridge has shown that the buoyancy the liver provides hangs on a knife edge. Add just a few pounds of weight to a tiger shark, and he'll sink.
Now, if by some biochemical mistake in the shark, it deposits a little too much oil in its liver and becomes buoyant, I think these old tiger sharks are doing what any good seaman would do for his ship under those conditions. He's simply taking on ballast. He's doing it to make himself a little more heavy so that his maneuverability is improved, and if his maneuverability is improved, then his chances for survival is improved. Sharks, after all these millions of years, don't do many things by accident.
The shark is a creature from the past. It stopped evolving 80 million years ago because it had reached perfection. And its perfection shows particularly in the way it locates its prey. In the late 60s, experiments began to reveal that sharks have a remarkable set of mechanisms for finding food. Mechanism one, sound. These sounds are artificial, but they mean something to sharks, and within seconds. Marine biologist Dr. Don Nelson.
One thing that these various playback studies have shown is this. To be attractive to sharks, the sounds have to be one, relatively low frequency, and two, pulsed, particularly if they're pulsed in an irregular or intermittent way. When we look at the natural sounds out there, we find that these are in the range of the so-called hydrodynamic sounds of fishes, from fishes that are struggling, like after they have been caught by a predator or escaping from a predator. And all of these things might indicate a feeding opportunity for a shark.
Scientists have shown that sharks' hearing is supersensitive, detecting sounds from over a mile away. This is a shark tank, but it's no ordinary one. In it, there's a 2-foot shark, and it's surrounded by $500,000 worth of high technology. Above, lights project down into the tank through polarizing filters. Photoelectric cells, hundreds of them, carpet the floor of the tank so that wherever the shark goes can be followed automatically. Speed, rates of turn, acceleration, all can be detected in this Aladdin's cave beneath. It's all fed into a computer, which can plot the shark's every movement. And all this for what? Prey sensor number 2, smell. In the tank, any one of over 200 holes can release a fine jet of odor. Today, they're using extract of shrimp, and the response is immediate. Shark's brain, small as it is, devotes over a third of its area to the perception of smell. It can detect odors in minute concentrations. Human blood, for example, down to one part in 10 million. But once it's picked up the smell, how does it localize the source? A current is produced in the tank. It's a very slow one, about 0.5 inch a second, barely perceptible. but it's quite enough for the shark. Researchers have been surprised by the speed with which the shark can pinpoint the source of smell. What's also puzzled them is how the shark can detect such a minute current. And that still is a mystery. Scientists now believe that a shark can pick up the scent of food up to half a mile away. And as it closes in, a range of about 100 yards, it switches to sense number 3. On each side of a shark's back, just beneath the skin, is a long tube. It's called the lateral line, and inside it, there are literally millions of tiny, supersensitive hairs designed to pick up the minutest vibration in the water. As it closes in for the kill, sense number 4, vision. But at the crucial moment, vision deserts it. Watch its eye again in slow motion. Inches away from the prey, the eyelid closes for protection. But the shark isn't really blind because it's already switched on sense number 5. What that fifth sense is, scientists are only now beginning to discover. And they believe it's electrical. These tubes can deliver a minute electric current when placed in water. The thought behind the new experiment is this. We've known for some time that any living object in water, be it fish, shark, or human, produces quite naturally a tiny electrical field. To detect it, you need sensitive instruments. But could the shark pick it up? Scientists began the test with a close relative of the shark, the ray. Rays are like sharks, only flatter. To the buried electrodes, the researchers delivered a current of 8 microamps, an exact simulation of the natural field around a fish. Later experiments with sharks confirmed the findings, and in the process cleared up a centuries-old mystery. In the wings of rays, strange tiny holes had been found. And in the shark, these same holes appeared under the jaw. No one knew what they were for, until now. Dotted regularly round the head, these hundreds of tiny holes contain cells sensitive to minute electrical fields. They are sense number 5. And with this discovery, the design of the perfect predator is complete. This is one place they've learned about perfection, and they've learned it the hard way. Over 200 Australians have been attacked by the perfect feeding machine. But is the shark machine really so perfect when its prey is man? Rodney Fox was attacked by a great white shark, supposedly the most vicious killer of them all. But the shark let him live to tell the tale. Henry Bourse was less fortunate, but he'd probably admit things could have been very much worse. Perhaps killer sharks aren't really killers after all.
Sharks have the opportunity to feed on people regularly and don't seem to do this as a matter of choice. A shark could, when it attacks, certainly totally consume its victim, did it so choose. But this very rarely occurs. Only about half of people attacked by sharks actually lose anything to the shark. It's become increasingly clear to us then that most shark attacks are probably not at all related to the shark trying to feed upon the victim.
One theory says it's a case of mistaken identity. In murky water, a diver could look like a fish. His gleaming white oxygen tanks might easily arouse a shark's curiosity. Helmut Himmrich is a diver who survived a shark attack in California. He was diving in murky water in an area frequented by sea lions when a great white shark suddenly struck. And it seems like diver and shark mistook each other.
My first thought was it was a sea lion, because there were sea lions in the area. But when he picked me up out of the water, then I realized it wasn't a sea lion. And he picked me up out of the water, started shaking me like a dog would shake a rag. And he swam with me towards the boat, and I was just hanging in his mouth, and he carried me maybe 15 feet or so towards the boat. And then that's when he released me at that time.
But mistaken identity can't be the whole explanation. Two diver scientists, Richard Johnson and Don Nelson, had another theory. And they decided there was only one way to test it. Cold-bloodedly attack the sharks. And what happened was this. The first recorded threat display by a shark. Until this experiment, we'd always thought sharks saw us only as prey. But this shark looked as though it regarded the scientists as potential rivals. It's not an experiment Don Nelson wants to repeat.
Well, you know, after we had taken this footage, we learned that there were several accounts where these same sharks in this posture had really vigorously attacked small research submersibles that were following them. And these were all out hard attacks where the shark just charged in and hit that submersible really hard, biting propellers and knocking out chunks of plexiglass and really shaking up the people inside.
It's now a scientific term, agonistic behavior. The typical posture, front fins down. And it strongly implies that sharks attack man not to feed, but to say, get out of my territory. Since then, the study has broadened. Near Catalina Island, off the coast of Los Angeles, Don Nelson and a team of graduate students are now trying to find out about sharks' natural behavior away from man. This is a package to be carried by the shark. It's a transmitter which will relay back information about the shark's depth, speed, and compass heading so they can keep track of its movements.
Speed sensor.
All right, we'll take this.
The device will stay on the shark for only a day or so. This spring is magnesium, designed to corrode in seawater and release the package.
Taste it.
How are you going to save up? Any appliance for that?
Yes.
On good days like this one, finding sharks is not a problem, but keeping them is.
All right, there you
go.
Jim, can you hold his hit?
I got him.
Is that a fish?
Yeah.
See if you can straddle him. Watch his feet, Sean.
It's a blue shark, one of the main species known to be in the area.
I think you better leave the hook in till we get the transmitter in.
Okay.
Where's the transmitter?
Okay.
Okay.
Need the keep that line tight on its head, okay, Jimbo?
Start
trying.
The recorder running, Jim.
I'm doing it.
Try it by hand somehow.
But don't pull that front eye. Don't put any pressure on the link. There you go.
It's everything's ready.
It's running though, right?
Running.
Okay. Okay, it's running, Jim, right?
He's right. Here
everything's
we go.
Running. Great.
Here we go.
There it is. There he goes.
Got it. Good signal.
Okay.
It's running.
Good. Well, congratulations.
That's
a good
one.
Sounds
good.
Tape's running well.
My gosh, I don't hear him all of a sudden.
It's still not strong, but it's...
Tracking will continue for over a day. At the end of it, the tapes are returned to the laboratory for analysis. Don Nelson hopes that the results may confirm the theory that sharks have territories. And with the help of data from his colleague Terry Shirota, a picture is emerging.
What Terry found was that during the day, these blue sharks more or less kept in one general area well offshore. But as soon as it became dark, they would move in a direct line in towards the island, spending most of the evening and late night along the island shoreline, and then moving back out to sea again before dawn. It tends to imply that they might have an offshore, inshore type of home range. This is a concept that's not very definite yet, but the fact that they are offshore and can find their way back in implies they know something about the environment.
The traditional image of the shark has been of an unpredictable creature, driven through hunger to wander alone in the deep. We now know that image needs changing. Perhaps, down there, sharks have homes. Sometimes sharks will defend their homes to the death. This is Manly Beach near Sydney, Australia. There's no shark fever here. Why? Because there are no longer any sharks off Manly Beach. 500 yards offshore lies the answer. A fishing boat on its daily round of thousands of yards of net. Manly Beach is surrounded by the stuff, and it's like flypaper on a mammoth scale. It's a perfect shark trap. Many sharks need to swim in order to breathe, and once caught in the net, they simply drown. The predator becomes the prey. Meshing began in Australia in 1937, and it's been expanding ever since. And ironically, it's given further weight to the new theory that sharks are territorial animals. Whenever meshing begins on a new beach, many sharks are caught. but after only 3 years, the catch will have dwindled to a quarter. A local population has been destroyed, never to return. The roles of hunter and hunted are reversed. In the whole world, there are, on average, only 25 shark attacks a year. The actual chances of being attacked are, to say the least, remote. So are we overreacting? David Baldridge.
Anyone who uses the sea for recreational purposes should realize that after they're in the water for a few moments, they've been sized up or examined by all forms of marine animals, including sharks. The choice to do something about it is theirs, not ours. And fortunately, they don't exercise this choice very often, only maybe 2 or 3 dozen times on a worldwide basis each year. So an unreasonable fear of shark attacks simply is not justified by the facts.
And these days, facts are hard to come by. But the mythmakers of Hollywood probably know almost as much about sharks as the experts.
Well, the primary problem is the simple fact that sharks don't want to work with us. So that means that we have to find a common denominator that allows us to have them do what we want them to do and still keep them from doing what they want to do to us. And for some reason, I don't think about a shark attack or a shark grabbing me because I come to realize that I have a pretty good defense. I have a nice block of aluminum. So I just swim along merrily as closely as I'd like to get to the shark and get as close up on his teeth if I want to.
That a shark can be handled at all is strange enough. But this one's a tiger shark, the infamous man-eater. Not surprisingly, the shark does sometimes object. But there's a remedy. Tie him up, tire him out, and the filming's just like baseball.
So during the scenes, what we do is have a pitcher and a catcher, you might call them. One diver holds the shark and gets him pointed in a direction and sends him in front of the camera. Hopefully, he'll go in the direction that we want him to go, and then the catcher or the other diver will try to recapture him by swimming down on him and grabbing his dorsal fin. And then if he doesn't react too violently, he'll grab his two pecs and hold on. Then other divers will come to his help.
We're never going to be bosom pals with a shark, but Jordan Klein believes we can at least have a genuine mutual respect for each other.
I think the average person that doesn't work with a shark or sees sharks very rarely has to be extremely respectful. I mean, for one thing, they're at home. That's where they've lived for eons. And we're a recent visitor. And they're entitled to their privacy to a great extent, and if you don't monkey with them, hopefully they won't monkey with you.
But the relationship between man and shark remains uneasy, and particularly if your job may land you in shark-infested waters. The men of the United States Navy have long memories. During the last war, sailors would survive being sunk by the Japanese and then fall prey to sharks. Since the war, the U.S. Navy has sunk many dollars in anti-shark research. This is a Navy research vessel. Beneath it, an observation chamber with all-round visibility. main thrust of the research? A whole range of anti-shark weaponry. They have tried more equitable methods, but without success. In the 1940s, they thought they'd found the answer. A mixture of black dye and copper acetate seemed the ideal repellent. But when tested in working conditions, it failed. The sharks simply ignored it. This is another idea. Jump into an inflatable plastic bag. This one works, but it's a bit restricting. So the best defense is still offense. Electric shocks. The tests were successful, and a weapon was developed. The electric dart. It paralyzes the shark. Another idea, the drogue dart. It's not a clean kill. The shark takes days to die. The CO2 dart. On impact, it releases a powerful jet of gas. It literally blows the shark up. And the latest weapon is the simplest and most effective of all, the power head. This research is for a genuine purpose, to protect men who work in the sea. But it symbolizes the link between men and sharks. For 300 million years, sharks have ruled the sea. But for the moment, they have been ousted by today's supreme predator, man.